Good morning, grade six. This is Mr. Clement, your English teacher, and I'm here to talk about Mrs. Frisby, chapters 3 and 4. There's our lovely little crow. That's the image we're going to be looking for on the website. Mrs. Frisby, chapters 3 and 4. Let me zoom in here so you can see as well as I can. In the first two chapters, we learn that Timothy has pneumonia and that Mrs. Frisby is a widow. The troubles are piling up on poor Mrs. Old Frisby. I say poor Mrs. Old Frisbee. Poor old Mrs. Frisbee. In chapter 3, we'll learn that her troubles are far from over. Questions for chapters 3 and 4 of Mrs. Frisbee and the Rats of Nim. Chapter 3, The Crow and the Cat. Jeremy, the crow, is in a sticky situation. What is his problem and how did it happen? Number 2. So you have two questions here. What is his problem and how did it happen? If you pay attention to the way I ask these questions, the first question of every chapter is a very easy question. It's something that you don't have to think about. You just tell me what the book says. The book tells you what his problem is, and the book tells you how it happened. You just have to repeat what's in the book. The second question, I normally do something that makes you think, that makes you have to come up with an answer on your own. So let's see what the second question says. Mrs. Frisbee saves Jeremy, which endears her to him. Endears means makes he owes her something, right? He says, "I am in debt to you. I am in debt to you. I owe you something. Based on what you already know about the characters, use your incredible powers of prediction to write a story about how Jeremy might help Mrs. Frisbee later in the book." So you know that Timothy's sick, you know that she needs to get some medicine to him. How might Jeremy help her later on in the book? List all words with which you had trouble. If this is blank, of course, you'll lose points. Chapter 2, Mr. Fitzgibbon's Plow. In Chapter 4, we find Mrs. Frisbee in a tough predicament. Explain her problem in detail. A predicament is a problem. Explain it in detail. Again, the first question is just something out of the book. Number 2, we get a money quote at the end of this chapter. So we discussed money quotes and we discussed the many faces of .com website. I'll take you there now so you can see what I'm talking about. You've seen this guy, Professor Snape. The same actor almost always plays villains. He hardly ever plays a good guy. Very rarely does he play a good guy. And he always has a money quote in each one of his movies. A money quote is like a quote that everybody remembers. It's a quote that is important to the character or to the story. So if we scroll down, I'm scrolling down, step 6, the money quote. In order to be a good villain, it says a sarcastic and pompous delivery is key for your money quote. A sarcastic and pompous, that means like you are full of yourself and you're not being truthful. So you have to have a sarcastic and pompous delivery. And this is the beginning of the end. It also harkens something in the story. It also tells us something in the story about the action or the plot of the story. So in this case, this is from the movie Robin Hood, and the money quote is somebody gives him an or he gives somebody else a sword, and the person says, "Oh, it's dull." And he goes, "It's dull. Well, that's good because it'll hurt more." It just shows you that his character's really mean. And the second one says, "You might be laboring under the delusion that the entire wizarding world is impressed with you." That tells us a lot about his character and a lot about how he thinks about Harry Potter, at least how we think he's supposed to think about Harry Potter. We find out differently, of course, as we go on. But in the first couple movies, Mr. Snape, Professor Snape is definitely bad. And this one's from Die Hard, when they're looking for the good guy, and the good guy's crawling around on the ground, and the bad guy, who is this guy that plays Professor Snape, says, "Shoot the glass so that the glass will fall and break, and then the good guy will have to crawl over it, and they'll be able to follow the blood trail." Gross. And this is from Quigley Down Under, a movie you guys probably haven't seen. I haven't seen either, but apparently there's a big quote where he says, "Oh, and by the way, you're fired." So A money quote is something that's important to the story, important to the characters, and tells us something about how the story is, how the plot is going in the story. I'm going to go back to the post here, inshallah. There we go. So, what is the money quote in chapter 4? Here's a hint. The key is that it is attributed to the recently deceased Mr. Frisby. There is a money quote, and we hear that Mr. Frisby said it. There's a quote from Mr. Frisby that's important to the story and that tells us something about the characters. Okay, find that quote and give it to me. That's all you have to do. And number three, list all the words with which you had trouble. Again, I was able to find that lady reading the book, so you can listen to it if you'd like. Listen to her read the book. She's got a nice reading voice. And she'll read it now. Go now. Well, you know how it works. Mr. Hould's probably uploading his podcast for the morning announcements and sucking up my bandwidth. In any case, I've got, again, both chapters, chapter 3 and chapter 4, and both of them are in two parts. And that's how that goes. If you have any questions, please put them in the comments section down here. I'd love to hear from you, and I'd love to respond to your questions. Close with our little bird there, birdie. All right. That is your Mrs. Frisbee homework for chapters 3 and 4.